Okay, good morning. We'll get started. And as the other times, we'll first spend a minute or two reviewing what we did last time, and then we'll proceed from there. So last time, we were looking at the dynamic instruction scheduling. And we said that here, the hardware determines the order in which the instructions execute. So the scheduling is decided dynamically or at runtime, in contrast to a statically scheduled processor where the compiler determines the order of execution. So we had seen that the other techniques to overcome hazards, forwarding, interlocking, software based approaches and so on, they have their own problems. So we said that we will investigate the dynamic instruction scheduling, which is based on the idea of data flow computation. So here we execute an operand as instruction as soon as its operands are available. But this is not exactly data flow computing. Can anybody answer why it is not really data flow computation as it was originally perceived? We defined what is a data flow computation, and we said that dynamic instruction scheduling is based on the concept of data flow computation, but is not data flow computation. Can anybody answer this question? Anyone wants to tell anything? Why dynamic instruction scheduling is not the same as data flow computing?
Data flow is instruction completion may be out of order,
okay,
but in dynamic it may execution out of order, but its completion in this in order, whatever it is.
Okay, not really. Any other answer?
Sir, data is available when there, but there is a queue initiations.
Okay, see, the answer is that the original idea of data flow computation, it says that execute an instruction as soon as its operands are available. There were no other constraints. But here, as we discussed yesterday, here even if and the operands are available, the instruction may not execute because there may not be space in the reservation stations, right? So there are resource constraints. Unlike the model in data flow computation, when the operands are available, executed, here we may not execute depending on certain conditions. For example, the required resource is busy and so on. So we said that whenever there is a dependency, there is a true dependency, we cannot do anything to avoid this, and the instruction has to wait. Same is in the case of dynamic instruction scheduling. But only thing is that the instructions that are behind it need not be blocked, right? So that would lead to out of order execution, but may not lead to out of order completion. So we explained it saying that, see, different instructions may take different amounts of time, and they might overtake each other during execution, right? So even though they might execute out of order, but something, their order might again change. And we said that we talked about the imprecise exceptions, right? So they must execute in their control order. We had told that yesterday. Just to clarify, in case there are any doubts, let me just explain the concept of a control dependency. See, imprecise, we'll discuss this a little bit more as we proceed, but we said that imprecise exceptions can arise if the control dependencies, you know, there are instructions which are control dependent on a branch instruction. So these are instructions and these are control dependent on a branch instruction, which means that these instructions execute only if the branch instruction satisfies certain conditions, otherwise they may not execute. So that is the terminology used in compilers and everywhere else, that the instructions are control dependent on another instructions, another instruction. And if there is a preceding branch also, let's say a nested loop, then they might be again control dependent on another instruction, right? So an instruction might be control dependent on multiple instructions. So an imprecise exception would occur if the before the branch instruction outcome is known, these the instructions complete before the branch instruction completes. Imprecise exception would occur if an instruction completes before the branch instruction on which it is control dependent completes. Branch instruction on which it is control dependent completes. The problem that would occur here is that when the branch instruction completes, it might be that these instructions should not have executed, because see, we are all using prediction techniques, right? So it might so happen that the branch instruction, the outcome is otherwise, and these instructions should not have been executed, and then there is no way to go back, isn't it? The completes means the results are written back into the registers, the results become visible, the results are updated on the registers. So we'll elaborate on this. So if the control order gets changed, then we say that an imprecise exception occurs. But just to clarify yesterday's point, the instructions among themselves, they might execute out of order. We'll just look at some examples and we'll clarify there. But the order, the control dependency is not changed, but the instructions among themselves might execute out of order. Let's just look at that. So we had said that the dynamic scheduling has many advantages. Many of the dependencies which cannot be handled by a compiler can be identified and handled, simplifies the compiler, allows code compiled for one pipeline to run on a different pipeline. And another important advantage is the hardware speculation. We will discuss this topic today, subsequently, where we'll say that see, we need not really stop if the branch instruction outcome is not known. We can even do better than that, and this is what is done in all modern processors. Not only they are dynamically scheduled, but speculative execution. We'll look at that. And then we said that there are two main techniques for dynamic instruction scheduling, which we'll discuss. First one is simpler technique, scoreboarding, slightly older technique compared to Tomasello's scheme. And we said that scoreboarding is quite intuitive, originally developed for CDC 6600. So the ID stage of the pipe is divided into two stages, issue and read operands. And once the hardware issues an instruction, the read operand stage occurs at the scoreboard. We had seen that yesterday. So the scoreboard has many responsibilities. The instructions wait in the scoreboard until their operands become available. and once the operands become available, the scoreboard decides when to execute. That is basically when the corresponding hardware becomes available, it will decide to execute it and also decides when an instruction can write its result into the destination register. And we said that this was the way to handle the WAW type and WAR type of dependencies. And we said that, see, this is not a good scheme actually, to let an instruction wait even if the execution is complete is not a good idea, because the functional units are wasting their time. So this is a renaming approach would have been much better, but scoreboarding doesn't do renaming. So we just discussed about this. The scoreboard is the central hardware which controls when an instruction will execute, checks when operands become available, and the operands are fetched from the register, right? The register contains the operand, and as a result there is an implicit delay. Even though the result is produced in the data bus, still it has to be written into the register. Until it is written, it cannot be retrieved by another unit requiring the same operands. And then we had looked at the four steps in executing scoreboard: issue, read operand, execution, and write result. So we have looked at the pros and cons, and we said that there are many ways in which the scoreboard could perform better. And then we said that Tomasello's scheme would overcome most of the shortcomings of the scoreboard. So here it was developed to keep the floating point pipeline as busy as possible. It was not really an instruction pipeline, the floating point pipelining, and also it does renaming in hardware. So all the modern processors, their instruction pipe is based on the Tomasello's algorithm. So we just looked at three key ideas: the reservation stations, common data bus, and the register tags. If you have any doubt anywhere we discussed last time, please raise that. So we had said that one of the key innovations is the reservation station. This not only decentralizes the control hardware, but also it renames the operands. So today let's proceed further and examine the Tomasello scheme in more detail. So here the reservation stations are associated with every functional unit, right? There might be multiple adders, multipliers, and so on, and there are reservation stations associated with them. So these store operands for the instructions, pending instructions, and as soon as the operands get their the instructions get their operands, they become eligible for execution. So we'll see that during issue stage. We'll look at it in slightly more detail. That during the issue stage, the operands are renamed. So here, instead of certain register value pointing to certain register value from where the operand would be obtained, what it would do is it will just provide a tag. It will, if the result is not already available in a register, it will only provide a tag to the corresponding reservation station where an instruction is waiting whose result would become the operand, right? It will only provide a tag, and therefore it achieves register renaming. As a result, it avoids WAR and WW type of hazards. And another thing is that, important question here is that somebody would agree, or somebody would argue, saying that see what these reservation stations are doing, why not we do with a large number of registers? We can provide thousands of registers, and then we can achieve renaming and all those things. So The answer is that many more reservation stations can be provided. But the question here is that why is it that many more reservation stations can be provided compared to registers? Would anybody like to answer this question?
It is distributed over the functional unit.
So reservation station is distributed. Some of the reservation stations are distributed to one functional unit, other is to.
No, but how does it prevent from having a large number of registers?
So
can't we have thousands of registers, like let's say 5,000 registers?
Means if some functional unit want to access that register, then they have to wait for one functional unit. If one functional unit access the register set, then other have to wait for that. So in that case, each reservation station has each functional unit has its own reservation stations.
No, see, I am not saying that the delay that would be caused by writing to register. I am asking a very simple question, that can we have a large number of registers? See, we are saying that we can really have large number of reservation stations, and these are much more than the registers. So what really restricts the registers? Assuming that the compiler can be written, we will write a complex compiler which will keep track of the registers. Are there any issues? Yeah, exactly. So that's the main difficulty here, is that as the registers increase, for every doubling of the register, 1 bit is required for every, not one, 3 bits, because there are 3 operands, right? So 3 bits, every doubling of register would increase the instruction size by 3 bits, and that really restricts the number of registers. Actually, the modern processors, they can provide much more registers than the 32 or 64 that is being provided, but that is restricted mainly by the problem with instruction size. But here, the reservation stations, the instruction doesn't really bother about reservation station. The instruction has operands in the registers, and the reservation stations are implicit. Right, so we can have many more reservation stations than the registers. So we can achieve renaming, and we'll see that the other advantages. So the results are passed from the functional unit to the functional unit from the reservation station. And once the reservation station gets all the operands, the instruction is fired or it gets executed. And also, just see that the reservation stations don't get their operands from the registers. They get the operands directly from the functional units through the common data bus. And therefore, this you can consider similar to forwarding. Even before the result is stored in the register, it's available to the reservation stations. And as we will see in the subsequent slides, we will see that the load stores in a dynamic instruction scheduling in Tomasello's algorithm, load stores are just like any other functional units. They have their own reservation stations. Even though we will call them slightly differently, we will call them load buffer, store buffer and so on, but they are just like reservation stations. And the integer instructions can go past branches and allows the floating point operations beyond basic block in the FPQ. So just because the instructions fire once they are in the reservation station, they can execute as long as their operands become available. So it is possible that they can go past branches. So this is the basic idea here. Let's try to understand this. See, every functional unit is associated with the reservation stations, and we said that this is one of the key thing in the Tomasello scheme. And the load store is also just like another functional unit. They also have associated load buffer, and then the store buffer has 2 units here. We'll explain that. And then the results produced either by memory unit or any other functional units are passed through a common data bus. And then they are written to the register, and simultaneously pass to the reservation station. So even before they are written to the register, the results become available to the reservation stations. So instructions are fetched here from the instruction queue, the hardware will fetch it and then check what type of instruction and see whether it can be allowed to, there is space in the reservation corresponding reservation station, then it will be queued there. And if it is a load store kind of instruction, the address unit will compute the effective address. And then for the load buffer, it will just store the address here, right. For the store, it will store the address here, but it will also have a store value, isn't it? The store value might either be available in the registers or it might be produced by another functional unit. If it is produced by another functional unit, then it will also get the data here. Maybe I should have, instead of drawing like this, I should have just drawn like this, that would have been easier. So it just gets the, reads the data from the CDB. And then when the load occurs, so these get queued here, so multiple loads can be waiting at the same time, and as it gets queued, as it gets executed here, the result fetched from the memory becomes available on the common database. If any instruction is waiting for that, it will directly get that and also updated in the register. That's the basic idea here. Are there any questions here on the basic scheme here? We'll just take with, we'll just examine this further with some examples, but if there are any questions here, we can answer. Okay, it appears all right for everybody. So let's proceed.
Sir, yeah. That manages the tracking thing.
Okay, so we have not really shown the hardware that would do the issue, the instruction issue. We have not shown it. There will be a hardware which takes instructions from the issue queue, sorry, the instruction queue, and then check if it doesn't suffer from a structural hazard. The structural hazard is basically there is no space in the reservation station, right? So if there is one instruction which has a structural hazard, there is no space, then the subsequent instructions will not be saved. That's the scheme here. If one instruction cannot be assigned to a reservation station, all subsequent instructions will stall until that becomes available.
This unit of reservation station should also send some feedback to the control unit.
No, okay, you are saying that whether space is available or not. Yeah, we are not showing that much detail, otherwise the diagram will become very complicated, right? Let us see that there is a control unit which does the instruction issuing here. Very simple hardware which just looks at the instructions and finds out what type of instruction, and then it does checks the corresponding reservation station and then checks if space is available. If space is available, issues it with operand renaming, because the operand might refer to a register and that register value might be written by another instruction under execution. So then what it will do is find out what is its place in the reservation station and then assign that tag here. So it is not really like a queue. The reservation stations are not like a queue, because once the instruction is assigned here, it doesn't shift any, because otherwise the tags will become improper, isn't it? Is that all right? So once the instructions are issued, there are three steps in executing the Tomasello scheme. The first one is issue. Here gets the instruction from the instruction queue, issue the instruction only if a matching reservation station is free. So a matching functional unit, if it is an ARD functional unit, there is at least one space in the reservation station. If the no space is available in reservation station, there is structural hazard and it will wait on the instruction queue. And also if the operand is already available in the register, it will just send the register value to the reservation station. It doesn't send the register name. Otherwise, that might lead to a hazard. But if the result is not already available in the register, the result will be produced by one of the instructions under execution, then it would just write the functional unit and the reservation station which is holding that instruction in the functional unit in the form of a tag. So you will just look at this with an example. And once the instruction become available through the common data bus, the operands become available, then it will execute.
Sir,
yes, please. You mean the reservation station, what is the logic how it will check whether the operands are available? We will look at an example. See, just to tell very briefly, in the reservation station, each entry of the reservation station will have one is the type of the instruction we will perform, because the adder also can do subtraction, multiplier can also do division and so on. So, we will have the exact operation that we need to perform, and then the value of operand 1, value of operand 2, tag for operand 1, tag for operand 2. So, if the value is already available, it is not going to be produced by another instruction under execution, it will be written directly here, and the instruction is ready for execution as soon as the execution unit is free to execute. But if some of the operands are not available so far, it will be produced by an instruction under execution, then we will write let us say reservation station 15. This is the pointer to a reservation station, the instruction waiting in certain reservation station which will produce this operand. And once the reservation station finds that a result is produced with this tag RS15, what it will do is it will delete this entry and write that value here, and this instruction becomes eligible for execution. Right, so that's the hardware, that's the logic required. We'll look at an example with an example. No, reservation station itself has the logic. No one checks here. The control is distributed here. Each reservation station monitors the common data bus and checks if any instruction that is waiting there, the tag matches with the result produced by the CDB. If the tag matches, then it will remove the tag here, write the result here, and this instruction becomes ready for execution. So, there is a small control unit associated with every reservation station. Even though we show the reservation station as only places to hold the operation and the operands, but it also has control logic. So, yeah, please. Yes.
That is sent by whom?
See, we'll just check that here. See here. Let's say this reservation station is RS15. Okay. So as the order produces the result, okay, the result will be tagged by RS15, saying that the instruction in the reservation station 15 is producing this result. So that will be checked by these reservation stations here, and or maybe even here. So they will check if there any of the operand is waiting for the instruction RS15, the result produced by RS15, and if it is produced, then they will just write it here. And same with the registers also. The registers also will wait for RS15. So if the RS15 is available, the register will also update itself. Right? Okay, we'll see with an example. I think that will make it clear. Oops. Okay, these are some old stuff that just came up. Okay, all these we had seen. Okay, so we're just discussing this. And once the instruction is taken for execution, and the result is written on the common data bus, here the execute also might take multiple cycles here, and then the write result will finish the execution and write on the common data bus, and all units would get the data waiting for this. So let's look at an example here. If we understand this example, we would understand how the Tomasello scheme works. So this is a small set of instructions: load F6 register with 34 plus is the displacement on R2, load F2 register, floating point register, 45 is the displacement on R3, multiply double, subtract double, divide double, add double, right? Some instructions are there. Now these are the load buffers we had discussed, and these are the reservation station associated with addition. There are three reservation stations. Okay, on the multiplier unit there are two reservation stations, and these are the functional registers, the floating point register, and then we'll let's just see how it will work. So this is as we check what happens in every clock cycle, we'll increment this value, and these are the load buffers. This is the instruction stream that we are discussing. This is the functional unit time. So each functional unit will take multiple cycles. Multiply might take 5 cycles. Addition might take 2 cycles, because these are floating point instructions that we are discussing. So 3 floating point adder reservation stations, 2 floating point multiplier reservation stations. So the first cycle, load is issued, and the reservation station or the buffer associated with the memory unit, the load buffer, gets the address 34 plus R2. Status changes to busy, and the result will be produced by F6, and therefore on the register we have a pointer to the reservation station here, load 1. Load 1 is the name of this reservation station. We can write RS1 or whatever if you please, but we are just simplicity have written load 1 so that we know which reservation station exactly. The second cycle, the second instruction is issued, and that is queued here, assigned to a second reservation station, and the result should be produced in F2, and therefore there is a pointer to the instruction which will produce the result. So just observe that we can issue multiple reservation stations, multiple load instructions to reservation stations. They are all outstanding. In the third cycle, the multiply instruction is issued out, and that is assigned to the reservation station with the multiplier. So this is the operation it will perform, double multiplication, and one result is already available. Right, F4 is already there, it is not being produced by any instruction under execution. That is why we wrote here the value directly, F4, whereas the other operand is not yet produced, will be produced by load 2. So we make a pointer to the instruction, to the reservation station, which will produce the result. Is that all right? And we also, since the result should be produced in F0, we also write a tag for the instruction multiply, which will produce the result, right? So this is the tag to this. So that's in clock cycle 3. Now load 1 is completing at this cycle, but what is waiting for load 1? Yes, so just see, load 1 F6 would be written here, right? So once it completes in the fourth cycle, we have the memory at certain address available here. The instruction has been taken out from the load buffer. Sorry, yeah, in the load buffer, the instruction has vanished, it has become available, and then here we have the value that has become available, and another instruction is issued out, right? The subtract instruction, the fourth cycle, it is assigned to a reservation station add 1. The operation it should do is subtract, and one operand is already available here. So it's provided here. The other one is a pointer to a reservation station, right? Load 2. And the next cycle, the load 2 is completing. Now what is waiting for load 2 is the F2 register, isn't it? And also the multiplier, the reservation station multiplier 1, isn't it? That's also waiting for load 2. Now let's see. Yeah, it has become updated here. It has got updated here, right? And even the subtract was waiting for that, isn't it? So the add is going to take another 2 cycles, and the multiplication is going to take 10 cycles. So the current clock cycle is 5. Now in the next cycle, one unit is over for this, one unit is over for this, and then the add double is issued out to this reservation station, add 2. And one of the operand is already available, the other one is a pointer, is a tag to the add 1 reservation station. Just see here. Okay, add 1 has been assigned to the subtract, isn't it? Sorry. So F8, right? So F8 data is required here. So there is a pointer or a tag to the subtraction operation here, right? Add 1 basically refers to this one. And here, just see that there is a dependency between, there is an anti-dependency between the subtract and the add double, isn't it? Subtract double and add double, there is an anti-dependency set up here. But still, it has been issued out. That's because we have achieved a renaming. There is nothing, no more F6 or something. We have just renamed it to the corresponding reservation station. So now the subtraction operation is going to complete. So that is F8. This is F8, and also there is this instruction is waiting for F8. So now just see that the tag is removed here, the value has become available here, right? And again F8 has been updated. So now there is one cycle to complete this one and 6 cycles to complete the multiplication. Now this has completed, the reservation station been updated. Now add also has completed. See, these are the instructions which have already completed. In the fourth cycle, the load has completed. In the fifth cycle, the other load has completed. In the eighth cycle, the sub subtraction has completed, and in the 11th cycle add has completed and have written the result to the register. But the instructions which are taking time are the multiplication and the division, because they take 10 cycles each to complete. So now one cycle for completing this one, the multiplication operation. So it has produces, it has produced its data now. So what is waiting for the multiplication is this one, isn't it? The division is waiting for the multiplication. So next cycle, this should become a value here, right? Yeah, it has become a value, and the other we reflect it as having completed here. So now the division operation will take 40 cycles to complete. So the division operation only one cycle to complete. Now the division has completed and the result has been updated here on F10, right? Division on F10, the result has been become available, and just see that the order in which they have written here is that the first instruction completed on 4th cycle, second one on 5th cycle, third one 16th cycle, fourth one 8th cycle, fifth one on 57th cycle, and this one on 11th cycle, right? So here they have been issued in order, just check at the issue 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, every cycle one instruction has been issued out. They have got executed out of order, like this has completed, right? Execution has almost completed here. And again they have completed out of order, but there is no violation of the control dependencies, right? Because there are no control instructions here. Does that appear all right? Any difficulties here? Okay. So let us look at the drawbacks of the Tomasello scheme. One drawback is the common data bus. What is the drawback here? Can somebody point out, because you have seen the working of the scheme. What is the difficulty with the common data bus? Yeah, the difficulty is that at any time only one instruction can write its result on the common data bus. As a result, one instruction only can complete its execution, right? So that is a bottleneck actually. And also it connects to multiple functional units. It leads to higher capacitance and wiring density and so on. And if we really want our processor to complete more than one instruction per cycle, which is a superscalar execution, a processor which issues more than one instruction per cycle and completes one instruction per cycle is a superscalar processor. So the scheme that we saw just now, one common data bus cannot be a superscalar processor. We would need multiple common multiple data buses, right? Multiple CDBs. And when we have multiple CDBs, we have also a problem of arbitrating between them, right? So we'll have more logic and more complex hardware. And the other is imprecise exceptions. Okay, I've written interrupts here, it should be exceptions. So let's see how imprecise exceptions would be handled. We somehow know little bit about imprecise exceptions. Now let's look at it in slightly more detail. We know that in a processor, the interrupts are either generated by external devices such as I/O devices or by the operating system itself. So what is the difference between the interrupt generated by operating system and by external device? Anybody knows about that? Yeah, the difference is the hardware interrupt by external devices, I/O devices, etc. The operating system generates the software interrupts. We are not going to discuss these things because these are not really something that we are going to is part of our course. But all of you should be knowing this, and looks like all know that. But those who don't know, please look up what is the difference between a hardware interrupt and a software interrupt. Where is it useful? How are they different, and so on. But exceptions are really they're different from interrupts. Exceptions are neither hardware nor software interrupts, but they are meant to notify of some internal errors. For example, illegal upcode, okay, need not be errors, in internal situations. It can be error and it can be otherwise. For example, it can be an illegal upcode, will generate exception. It can be a divide by zero exception. It can be overflow, underflow exception. Even a page fault can generate exception. And when an exception is generated, then the operating system would receive the exception, and it is it should take actions based on that. It should decide what to do. But what about imprecise exceptions? An exception is called imprecise when the processor state, when an exception is raised, does not look exactly the same compared to when the instruction are executed in order. And here, in order, we mean in the order of their control dependency. In an out-of-order execution model, an imprecise exception is said to occur when the exception is raised by an instruction. Some instruction, that is control instructions, before it may not be complete, and some instructions after it have already completed. Okay, so we know the examples and so on. Let's not spend time on that. Now, let's look at handling imprecise exceptions in the dynamic scheduling approach. We had seen that instructions are issued out in order, right? In 1, 2, 3, 4 subsequent cycles, the instructions are issued out, they are executed out of order. But unless the control dependence is resolved, an instruction is not executed. We didn't discuss this step actually. We looked at the examples, we did not discuss this step. See, unless the control dependence has got resolved, the branch on which it is control dependent has already completed its execution, it's not taken up from the reservation station and executed. It just keeps on waiting there. No instruction is allowed to initiate execution until all branches that precede the instruction are complete. But this is a performance bottleneck. Reservation station might be available, sorry, the functional unit might be available, but the instruction keeps on waiting in the reservation station just to wait for the control dependency to get resolved. This is a performance bottleneck, because you will encounter the control dependencies very often, almost at every 6 instructions. So we will see that we will try to overcome this in the speculative execution. I think we'll just take a break here, and we'll continue with the speculative execution.